I got the horse right here, the name is Paul Revere, and here's a guy that says if the weather's clear, can do, can do.
Hello, racing fans, and welcome back to another edition of Handicapper's Corner, brought to you by the Derby Bar and Grill. I'm Mike Hansen with Drew Forster. We're going to go through the Sunday, July the 22nd races at Hastings. We do have seven races on tap. No stakes race, but a good allowance feature for the fillies, and that'll be a good event. But
keep your eye on the pick five too. See if it goes five. On Saturday.
Carry over going into the Saturday program, but so yeah, keep an eye on that as you mentioned. Let's get right into the action. Sunday program just begin with a Nonwars of Two Lifetime going a mile on the 16th. Didn't get a whole lot of entrants, but we got five of them signed on. I went to the four horse Chase the Money. I don't like anyone in here, to be honest. I'm not going to hang the one has a shot because has speed. Manning hasn't run a yard since coming here to Hastings, but does have some back, not back class, but at least he's been running better in races in Phoenix on the turf. Cash Hit ran his best race of the year last time, so he's eligible. And Sheriff Clark hasn't run a race. You know, this horse has been got beat up bad, I know, against better horses, though. But it was tough to find one, and I went Chase the Money. Yeah. That third behind Fear of the Cat and New Dreams, is that the strongest race? No. But at least it was a third, at least this horse is moving forward and passing horses, and that was as much as I needed to make a bit of a pick in here. I put Manning in for second, and I put the five-horse Sheriff Clark in for third. I didn't love anyone in here.
Yeah, it's a tough one. So. I know. We're going long. I went to the five Sheriff Clark just because of the big drop, and Phil Hall's our leading trainer. He's making all the right moves right now. Amadeo Perez and Phil are teaming up good together, so why not? In an absolutely wide open event. I put Cash Hit in the second spot. He might get the lead here.
This is okay. Cash Hit's okay.
He could be on the lead, and maybe they never catch him. So maybe Cash Hit is the...
I don't like anyone.
It's a one. The all-button race. Maybe Cash Hit for second. I put Manning in for third. I got no idea. I'm with Mike. 5, 3, and 2. Take your pick in the first. It's a wide open race.
Served only five of them, but we served them a daily.
Yeah, that's right. On to the second. Claiming 4,000. Fillies and Mares. Non-words of the year. Non-four. Yada, 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 all those conditions. I went to the six of Riki Princess. Hasn't run yet this year, but she's been training the lights out, training very well for this. Actually, was training up at Northlands Park.
I don't know why, but she was
Yeah, I don't know. She was in Edmonton. Worked in a minute and two, then came down here, worked in a minute flat on the 14th. So 5 days ago, it's a nice work. Not a terribly tough field she's facing. If she runs back to any of those buyers she was running her last five or six races, I think she absolutely runs away from this field. So I got a Riki Princess on top. Put Storm Cruise a good third behind Go-Go Eileen and Belly Girl last time. See how Belly Girl runs on Saturday in the last on Saturday, and that might tell you more about Belly or Storm Cruiser. Her in for second, and I threw in Lady Cash for Hall of Fame trainer Frank Barraby in the third spot. Another tough one to pick one. 6-4-3 for me.
Yeah, I went Storm Cruiser on top. Pace Casualty going long last time, but this horse did a lot of fighting and actually hung in pretty good. Return to a sprint could be what the horse needs.
Yeah.
This is banking that a Riki Princess needs a race. I don't know the status of a Riki Princess, but her form has been pretty solid throughout her career. She always shows up. And I put the two-horse Fire Beauty in the mix, reclaimed by Mel Snow. And she's live in here. It could be the inside speed. Well, Gold Girl's got speed, but she should sit a good second and have every shot from there. I went 4, 2, and 6 on Sunday second. On to the third race, Fillies and Mares, Nonwars of Three Lifetime, going 6 1/2 furlongs. The two-horse Tattooed Kitty, she ran a big race. Good second to a notice, and we can tell you that she isn't full.
She isn't full.
She's in full.
She's with child.
She is with child, and I noticed that in the racing office.
Yeah.
Prior to run, actually, just after she ran, or she was already in. We'd already done the show, or I would have mentioned it last time. But Tattooed Kitty still ran a big, huge race. Well clear of Peach Pike, who was the third horse. I noticed did beat her that day.
It's between those
really
two.
Close.
But I went with Tattooed Kitty as well because Tattooed Kitty hadn't run since March.
Yep.
And I noticed the timing of the races were better, so she could get more out of that and try and turn the tables on her today.
Yeah, and Tattooed Kitty got pressured by another horse to the opening half.
Yeah, got softened
up. Opening quarter, and I noticed was sitting in the pocket, and then it didn't even have to go around the horse. The other horse tired and an Otis just slid right through under Amadeo Perez and got a really good run. It was as perfect as can be for an Otis. So, and just still barely ran by Tattooed Kitty. So those two for me are inseparable. I put the 7 Jane in for third. I think she'll appreciate running back to a sprint, and she is dropping in class. I thought she was the third best horse.
I don't know much to add. I got the same top two, Tattooed Kitty and an Otis. I'd have both those in my pick five ticket or early pick threes or whatnot. Those are the two I like. I threw in Sweet 16, the other Mark Cloutier runner in here, broke her maiden for 25, then tackled some tough horses, Under Par, Lookout Taylor, Cypress Park. Like, those are considerably tougher than what she faces today. She drops into an 8 and on 3, and that could be more what she likes. 2, 6, and 1 for me in the third. On to the fourth. Babies.
Going six
furlongs.
Here. We got 8 boys and 1. I know there's 1 filly in here, Honky Tonk
Woman. Honky Tonk Woman. That's the one I went to out of the Anita Bolton barn. Well-bred daughter of violence that they bought at the BC sale last year. She's got some nice works. Most recently in 59 and 4.
Yeah, she
looked
good.
Nice work for a baby coming up. I like the name too, Honky Tonk Woman. The old stone.
She looked great in the paddock. I saw her paddock schooling today, and she looked really good. You know,
good looking filly
and handling everything. You know, it was just the morning, and there's not a lot of activity in the morning, but still, it's nice to get them over there.
She was cool about it.
She looked really good in the paddock.
So I left out. As we'll go along here, I left out Numani's Reward just because I'm looking. He's going to be a short price in here. He's going to be your favorite. But he's had 3 chances, just missed by a head last time. And I'm looking for a horse that can maybe surprise. That's why I put Honky Tonk Woman on top of Explode. This guy ran good his first start. It was a maiden 75, which is basically a maiden special weight. Behind Notice was a half length clearer horse and was wide, was going 3.5. Will like the distance change. Amadeo Perez sticks with him, and Mark Cloutier always tough together. So I'm going to put Explode in the second spot. And I'm going to throw in Midnight in Maui for Dave Forrester. Arnie Benowith owns this son of Midnight Loot. They paid a bunch for at 100. The sale last year, 100 for at the sale last year. And he's been kind of a slow learner. Mm-hmm. And I know Scott Williams, it's listed as no rider. Scott Williams is going to ride him.
Yep.
He got on him, worked him today, I believe, and apparently...
Yeah, blew out.
Blew out, and Scott hit him a couple times, said he really seemed to focus. He is kind of a slow learner. That's, you can see that through his works, as he's taking some time. Probably going to need a race, but I could see him getting up for third, so I didn't want to leave him out. 4-2-7 for me.
Yeah, I went with Numani's Reward. There's no money in loving Numani's Reward, but... I like the blinker change. This horse ran like a horse twice now that needs blinkers.
Yeah.
Just running spotty. This horse was flying at the end of the move on that day race. I know he's coming back in 8 days. But Numani's Reward was full of run at the end of it and just kind of loses focus in places, critical places in a race. And the blinkers, I think, will keep him a little more up, I'm hoping. But once again, I'm not going to get rewarded with, you know, like a 5-to-1 mutual or anything. You're going to get 2-to-1 or 5-to-2 or something.
Probably going to be 6-to-5
at best. But Numani's Reward for me, I agree with the 4 Honky Tonk Woman. I respect the connections. Nick and Pauline Felicella, like huge supporters of the game that have just deserved nice horses. They spend the money. And Anita Bolton does a great job. This horse, as I mentioned, looked great in the paddock when I saw her. Has looked good in the mornings. And, you know, the filly race didn't fill, so they opted to... It was the same day. The filly race didn't go, and so they switched against the boys. And I think she's every bit as good as any of the boys. And I put the 1, Stay Fantastic, for Mike Anderson.
Yeah, Stay Thirsty.
Fantastic Command is the half-brother. But this one's by Stay Thirsty, who the last couple of works have been really good. And each 5/8 has been getting progressively faster, which you like to see. And it looks like he's got some talent as well. So I put 3, 4, and 1. I went 3, 4, and 1. But there's some nice horses. I left your dad's horse out, Midnight in Maui. Call It a Wrap for Craig McPherson.
Yeah, I looked at that one.
Nice little horse working well with Hamill on the outside. Shruggy Bear. It's a good raise. But I did go 3, 4, and 1 in race number 4. On to the 5th race, maiden $16,000 claimer for fillies and mares, going 6.5 furlongs. Once again, I'm going to go 3, 4, and 1 in here. I went 3, 4, and 1 in the last race. I'm going to go S.E. Rose. Looks like Mike Anderson's got the aces in here, S.E. Rose and Sun Renita. Neither have an abundance of speed, which is a bit of a concern, but there isn't a lot of speed in the race. But I think both have the best closing speed, and I like both of those fillies. And I put the 1 Second Solo in for 3rd. I would play all 3 of them. Second Solo was battling on the head end last time with the eventual winner, another Mike Anderson horse. Babylon Will Fall. And, it did tire late, but there's absolutely no speed in this race.
I don't see a whole lot of gas in here.
Second Solo is going to get the lead. absolutely by himself. I unless the eight excessive belief really goes and ruins his day or something. But
significant rider change there too. Goes from Lenny Cistron to leading rider Enrique Gonzalez. Too. Yeah, that's not going to hurt.
That's a big move. But I thought SC Rose and Sun Radio were the best, you know, horses with the best numbers and just. I think the live ones in here. I went 3-4-1.
I agree. I put Essie Rose on top. That is a good second behind Stanley Babylon Will Fall last time. If she runs that race back, she's probably going to be tough in here. I put Mousy Mousy, the Rob Gilker horse, in here. We saw these guys, we should mention, we saw these guys, Rob Gilker and Amadeo Perez, team up to win the Monashy last weekend with Victorious. Well-timed ride by Amadeo Perez there. This horse ran a good race first out behind Sweet 16 and Maiden 25. Off of that, they put her up into a maiden special weight. She ran fifth. That was a bear race. Now down in for 16, goes on the Lasix program, and these guys always tough together. I didn't want to leave Mousy Mousy out for Teddy Smith. And I put Mike's other horse, Sun Renita, coming off a good second at this level last time behind Jaina, in for third. 3, 2, and 4 for me in the fifth. On to the sixth. Three-year-olds, optional 25. It's the boys' turn. We have the girls on Saturday and the boys here on Sunday.
That's what it was. Yeah, I did off the top say that the fillies were the feature today.
That was yesterday.
Yeah, the boys are the feature.
Boys today. I went with Minor Heat. We've seen this move before. Peter Edicop bringing one in from down south, and they've been tough so far this year. Leading trainer Phil Hall, Amadeo Perez, those trio have teamed up nicely. Broke his maiden at Will Rogers Down.
You don't see that every day.
Mm-hmm. By 11, no less. Went over, ran in a couple. Those optional 40s at Golden Gate are dirty tough. Has come here, worked well. Blinkers go on, as I mentioned, top connections. I'm going to take a chance. Minor Heat's good enough to beat these. Minor Heat for me. On top of Next Otis, I'm going to throw him in there. He's been running good. Won a maiden 25. Come back, just beat out Ezekiel and give me some slack in an allowance race. Didn't disgrace himself in the River Rock. Only got beat 3 lengths. Last time an allowance race with
against older horses.
That's the angle I looked at earlier. His time to shine. Spring in Alberta, always sunny. That's tougher run against those older horses. Back in against three-year-olds, he needs to be respected. Next Otis, for me, and Panhandle, because he always hits the board, finally broke his maiden last time, runs big races, never quite seems to get there. I can see him hitting the board in here for sure. 2-4-3 for me.
Yeah, this race, I had a lot of trouble with. I went with your top horse, too.
Minor Heat, yeah.
The Oklahoma Bred obviously broke his maiden in an Oklahoma Bred race at Will Rogers Downs, and then was purchased privately by Peter Edicop and sent to the Blaine Wright barn. And the horse has been okay in Golden Gate in those first condition races. But like the two works since arriving here, and gets blinkers. And there's lots of reasons to like Minor Heat. Obviously,
he's getting well bet down there too, right? You know, 3-1, 5-1.
That was a tough race. The first one, look at next out winners, Daddy's Prize and Joe Jackson. Yeah. His first race at Golden Gate. I mean, he wasn't running against any bums. And he just finds it, I think, a pretty good field here. I put Panhandle in for second. Richard Hamill got to give a great ride. Got up on the inside, won in 16 and 4.
Almost got in trouble down the lane there. Chances are ducked out right in front of him, and Richard kept riding, got there.
Kind of got out under left-handed urging was the chances are, and then Panhandle ducked to the inside, but got the win. But Richard Hamill's not on the horse because Aaron Grider is the barn rider.
He was down riding Boundary Bay in Seattle that day.
That's why Aaron is on the horse. It's not because Richard didn't want to ride the horse or anything.
Yeah.
It's didn't choose it. And obviously, he rides the one horse. He didn't choose the one horse.
Over Panhandle, yeah.
Correct. Yeah. And no, it's just because Aaron is the barn rider, and he was, as you mentioned, out of town. I put the six horse, Mighty Mick, in for third. Good runner-up effort, AF Indy. Didn't get the best of trips that day. His horse is running on well at the end of the race. I wish it was mile 16, but it isn't, but that's why I've got him in the third spot. I've left out Ezekiel Ferdino, the next Otis.
Slew the Boss.
And Slew the Boss. They're both nice horses for Mel. Yeah. It's a good race. There's no one that stands out. Like, Minor Heat could run last, and it could win. I don't know where.
Last time Slew the Boss sprinted, he only got beat a length and a quarter in the stake behind Wise Market and Argosy Fleet, so he's another one live in here.
Give me some slack. That is a good race.
It is a good race.
I went 2-3-6 in the feature at Hastings on Sunday. On the seventh and final, good race here, too. $16,000 older horses going long. I went to the two-eyed goodest. I don't love the horse. He had no excuses last time. He was outrun by All Under Control, but I'm going to try him. He is inside of All Under Control today, and I think he could maybe set the pace if Heartset doesn't give him too much grief. I put the six-horse Royal Briar, who could get a good pace to run out in for second. He had no pace to run out in his last couple, actually his last three routes. Every time, 24 and 3, 24 and 4, 24 and 2. The halves are dreadfully slow. Ida Goodis got away with easy fractions to get some two and three back, and Hartsett got away with easy fractions last time. So Royal Breyer, I think, is live, and I put Ace Deuce in for third. He's got some back class, and he won very easily at the $8,000 level. He might get a nice trip in behind the speed. I went 265.
I went to All Under Control. I thought a good race last time against tougher Square Dancer, Handsome Chef, Sergeant Rick. He ran the best in that 25. In for 16. Mike Anderson's horse is running really good right now. The last couple weeks, he's warmed up.
Four or five last couple weekends.
No, he's gotten really hot. So All Under Control for me over Ida Goodis. I like the two coming out of that race at 25. Everybody else has been kind of hovering around this 12-5. 16 level. Those are the two that jumped up, ran tough races. Actually, well, Ida Goodis jumped up, but All Under Control's been up there all year. You know, beat a neck by Corky's Luck, ran to hold the giant Square Dancer last time. He gets class relief. I think that could do it for All Under Control. I agree with Ida Goodis. Run really good since coming here to Hastings. You know, tougher race last time. Back in where he had his success, and Phil Hall and Enrique Gonzalez, everything out of the Phil Hall barn has to be respected right now. And then the third spot I threw in City Steel, just because if it gets hot up front, there is a fair bit of pace in here. He closed a lot of ground last time, only got beat two lengths. He was dead last for the whole race, came charging late, got a little bit of trouble, and only got beat a couple lengths. And if it gets really hot, he's the big closer that could come and run him down under Dennis Arrojo. So I didn't want to leave him out City Steel. 3, 2, and 4 for me in the nightcap. That'll do it for our analysis of the Sunday card. Up next on screen will be our picks.
Back in race number one, I went up first. Four. Here we go. Chase the money. We're going to try and chase the money in the opener.
We're always chasing
Alex
the money.
Murray. I know. 4, 2, and 5 in the Sunday opener on race number two. I went to the 4 again, Storm Cruiser. 4, 2, and 6. Race number 3, I went to the 2, Tattooed Kitty over the 6 and Otis. I think it is 2 and 6 in there, though, but I went 2, 6, and 7. Race number 4, I went to the 3, Numani's Reward with the blinkers on. 3, 4, and 1. Race number 5, I went to the 3, S.E. Rose over the 4, Sun Renita. I think the Mike Anderson runner is going to be tough. 3, 4, 1. Race number 6, I went to Peter Redekop's Minor Heat for Phil Hall. 2, 3, and 6. But a very good allowance race. It's got a lot of competition. And the 7th and final, I went to the 2, Ida Goodis. Going to go 2, 6, and 5.
On to my picks back in the first, I went to the 5, Sheriff Clark over the 3 and the 2. In the second, her first start this year, number 6, Ariki Princess over the 4 and the 3. The third, I agree with Mike on number 2, Tattooed Kitty over the 6 and the 1. In the fourth, I went to the 4. This is a baby race, Honky Tonk Woman over the 2 and the 7. In the fifth, I went to the 3. I agree with Mike here, S.E. Rose over the 2 and the 4. We agree again in the 6, Peter Redekop's number 2, Minor Heat over the 4 and the 3. In the nightcap, I went to the 3 horse, All Under Control over the 2 and the 4.
That'll do it for the Sunday edition of Handicapper's Corner. Hopefully everyone's enjoyed the show. And just want to briefly touch on last weekend's stakes activity.
Yeah.
Victors, of course, won the Monashy in very
Saturday,
nice fashion, defeating Yukon Bell. And then the boys' race, Calgary Caper, won, defeating Modern. Yeah. And the reason I touch on this, because
Swift
Thoroughbreds have retired Modern. That was his last race. He went out on a good note. He ran so good.
He ran a big race.
He ran 23, 46 and change, 110 and change, and kept running, but fought on well under Richard Hamill. And
he's been such a cool horse for those guys.
Dino had said before the race, like it was going to be his last race. And I go, after the race, I went up and saw Dino, and he's getting one more for sure.
Yeah, that's what I thought after he ran so good that they would try him again.
Nope. That he is retired. He's currently at the Southlands. He's going to try and make a riding.
He's a gelding.
Yep. He's a gelding, and he's a cool horse. But kudos to the Swift Thoroughbreds, who campaigned him beautifully, and Dino as well. He was a well-thought-out horse. Like he brought out a schedule for him. And every year, and they got the most out of Modern. He has his little issues, and they did a very good job with him. And
absolutely.
You always
kudos
hate to see a good stakes horse leave the scene, but I just wanted to touch on Modern.
Also, the way that they retired him on top, too. You know,
he was
running good. They didn't start running him in 25 or anything.
No. I know. Yeah. They're too classy. Mark and Horatio and their wives, you know, like they're such classy people. And nice to see, as you mentioned, go out kind of on top with a nice runner-up effort.
Yeah.
Didn't run 8th, beaten 37 links. Now we're going to retire him or anything.
It was or drop him down or anything. It was just like,
that's cool. But sad to see Modern go, but he was a great institution at the older horse division over the past five years
at least.
And cool horse for them. And it's great to see him getting in. He's going to go on to a new career.
Tip of the cap to Modern. Absolutely.
Nice. Well, that'll do it, as I mentioned, for this edition of Handicapper's Corner. On behalf of Drew, thanks for tuning in. We'll see you next time here on the Friday night.
That's right, Friday night.
Next Friday night, July 27th.
Nothing changes, though, as far as we go. This will still be on Thursday.
Thursday, yep. We'll have the show on Thursday. We'll do the Friday, Sunday. That'll be the next weekend. It'll be Friday, Sunday. Friday night, though, at 7 o'clock. It should be a lot of fun, the Friday night lives again. On behalf of Drew, thanks for tuning in. We'll see you next time here at the Derby Bar and Grill for Handicapper's Corner.
I got the horse right here, the name is Paul Revere, and here's a guy that says if the weather's clear, can do.